So breathing routine and calming the central nervous system, you have to do double inhalations through the nose and an extended exhale, especially when working out. 2 to 3 cycles, repeated 1 to 3 times between sets, will help with heart rate variability. Can you talk a little bit about that? And one, I did it, and it actually does work. Because I'm in fitness and nutrition, and I would like to think that I know how to breathe, but we're very shallow breathers, and being conscious of this in between sets and working out or sprints really did help bring this sense of calm and recovery to me.
Yeah, so my lab's been focusing on how respiration impacts states of mind. And when we say states of mind, I mean the brain, right? Mm-hmm. I use brain and mind mostly interchangeably. In fact, there's a study that we're doing right now, we meaning me and a guy named David Spiegel, who's in our department of psychiatry, he's a professor and MD there, looking at how different patterns of breathing impact brain states. Why breathing? Well, the diaphragm, which is a skeletal muscle, unlike other organs, it's skeletal muscle, just like a bicep or quadricep, can work involuntarily. You're breathing all day, you're probably not thinking about it most of the time, and while you sleep, but you can take conscious control over that diaphragm through a nerve pathway called the phrenic nerve, P-H-R-E-N-I-C, phrenic. Hmm. How fast that diaphragm moves signals to your brain how alert your brain needs to be. So it's kind of, you know, we don't really think about this, but your brain needs to know how alert or how sleepy to be, depending on the movement of your body. Well, how does it get that information? It's not feedback from the muscles. It's not lactic acid in your system, because most of the time you're not generating a lot of lactic acid just walking around.
Yeah.
When you're breathing fast, the diaphragm is sending more signals, and when you're breathing slowly, it's sending fewer signals per unit time, and you get more alert or calm, depending on whether or not it's more signals or fewer signals. The double inhale, ideally both inhales through the nose followed by an exhale, is a particularly important pattern of breathing for people to know about and to adopt. They are called physiological sighs. The discovery of these physiological sighs dates back to the 30s. And in recent years, it's been discovered that there's a set of neurons that in the brainstem that are specifically responsible for generating physiological sighs. Believe it or not, everybody does these periodically throughout sleep. And under conditions where carbon dioxide in our system gets too high, people will spontaneously use this physiological sigh. Why? Well, when you do that double inhale, it's like taking a deep breath. So people say you're stressed, take a deep breath. Well, you take a deep breath, but then that second little inhale at the end where you sneak in just the tiniest amount of extra air fully expands these little sacs in the lungs, which then when you exhale, pulls an additional amount of carbon dioxide out of the bloodstream. So you offload more carbon dioxide, which brings you to a level of calm very quickly. Put into plain English, double inhale followed by exhale is the fastest way to calm your brain and nervous system. We have to remember that the mind is the nervous system and it's talking to the body all the time, and the body is talking to the brain all the time through these nerve pathways. So if you look at breath work, or you look at yoga, or you look at all this kind of stuff around breathing, that's all wonderful. Wim Hof breathing, Tummo breathing, Patrick McEwen stuff, Brian McKenzie's doing fabulous work, the Laird and Gabby, you know, Laird Hamilton, Gabby Reese, wonderful stuff with breath work. But my lab was really interested in what are the tools we can use in real time to offset stress?
Yeah.
Because so there are two reasons to do this kind of breathing. The double inhale, exhale, you can intersperse between sets. You can do it during a conversation. You can do it while driving home. You can do it while getting a troubling text. You can do it anytime you're feeling like your level of alertness is too high. Now, and you want to bring your level of calm up and your level of alertness down. Yep. Now, why would you want to do that in a workout? Well, heart rate variability we know is good. And toggling between states that are very high intensity and lower, what so-called parasympathetic states throughout the day is good, meaning being stressed, being relaxed, being stressed, being relaxed. We think of stress as bad, but chronically high stress is bad.
Right.
So right. I said, when you wrote and said, you know, what's a practice to adopt, I wanted to make it very concrete. And since you're a guy that does regular workouts, big part of your life, we know that your ability to focus in a set and to generate energy and effort is proportional to how much you've managed to rest and achieve deep states of relaxation between sets. sometimes we call that sleep between workouts, right?
Yeah.
If you ever had a workout after a bad night's sleep, it's very different than after an awesome night's sleep,
yeah,
night huge. And day.
Yeah.
Well, on a more micro scale, if you can bring your nervous system into states of deep relaxation between sets or quicker, deeper relaxation, you don't want to fall asleep, obviously, you're going to be able to generate more focus and intensity in the subsequent set. So I have a practice of that's based on these physiological size of bringing, of making, after I'll set down the weight or finish the interval, the first thing I'll do, I actually consider it part of the set just to remind myself to do it. I'll do one or three physiological size. And so you're generating a lot of heart rate variability by employing these neurons in the nervous system that were designed to quickly calm you. And this is also because controlling the mind with the mind is very hard. If you finish a set or you're stressed, it doesn't matter if it's a joyful thing, like because you enjoy working out, or you're stressed from a life event, and you tell yourself to calm down, you can't just tell yourself, I mean, you can tell yourself, but it doesn't work. Right. You need to employ the body. You need to employ physiology. And the last thing I'll say about breathing is that there are other breathing practices that involve sitting for 5 minutes or 10 minutes and doing a specific pattern of breathing, so-called breath work. And those have a utility too. Box breathing, Tummo breathing. We can talk about any and all of those if you want.
Yeah.
But I think it's nice that people have in their kit a tool that works the first time, works every time, and was designed for the purpose of calming us. You know, I didn't invent this tool. Mother Nature holds the patent for this. It probably dates back hundreds of thousands of years.
Sure.
Everyone has these neurons and uses them spontaneously from time to time, but they can be employed voluntarily. And so that's why I suggested it.
Yeah. And that makes a ton of sense. Anybody listening, heart rate variability is just basically a measure of how well we're recovering and how well your body is recovered. So if you don't get a lot of sleep or we're chronically stressed, as Andrew said, that our body is just at an elevated level. We have elevated levels of cortisol, and stress isn't a bad thing. Working out naturally is a stressful response, but being able to reel that back by taking these deep and that double inhalation and exhalation really does just give you a sense of going between, parasympathetic and sympathetic, you know, sympathetic when we're working out. So that fight or flight, or, you know, rest and digest. So that did really help me. I was doing this when I was doing sprints, and I was only doing 10-second sprints, which you can't really sprint any longer than that for anybody listening. You can't run as fast as you can for 30 seconds. Usain Bolt only runs for like 9 seconds, and the dude's coasting halfway through. So this was really interesting to do, because most of the time, yeah, I would do like box breathing afterwards, or I'd lay on my back, or just, you know, kind of try to do different things. But this was something that I could see that, as you mentioned, when people get stressed, especially in 2020, it's been a hell of a year. As my wife and I like to say, I don't know what level of Jumanji we're in each time between COVID and everything else and murder hornets or whatever the hell's going on. We just enter these other levels. So I think that this would be a good thing for people just to incorporate, you know, throughout the day as well when they're getting stressed. So that makes a lot of sense, and it's nice, tangible information that people can do.